I'm joined now by Jason Thomas. He's the head of research at Carlyle Investment Management. And Jason, you wrote a fantastic report on this that I got a chance to read over the last couple of days. You actually found that diversity makes a measurable difference in the firms that you studied increasing revenue, and even more in terms of increasing profit.
Yeah, you know, most of the research as it relates to impact is a question of losses, or at least it's returns that are foregone to have an impact. And we think this is actually the
people
wrong
expect
way.
To give something up.
Oh, exactly.
If I'm going to
exactly.
invest in, to, and support the climate, I'm willing to make less money.
Exactly. So I think the research is really has the wrong orientation, because what we found is that the societal goals of the impact investor, particularly diversity and inclusion, but also environmental sustainability governance, are actually increasingly the sources of incremental returns. So not only are you not surrendering some upside or not surrendering some return, it's actually precisely those channels that generate the returns in a market where assets are so fully valued, and all of the routine or conventional ways of adding value are all really incorporated into the bid price and the asset prices. You mentioned diversity and inclusion. When we looked at all of our U.S. data, we found that diversity, those boards that had two or more diverse board members, actually generated earnings growth that was 12% per year faster than those boards that lack diversity. So very interesting findings. And again, I think you...
Revenue growth.
Right? Top-line revenue growth. Yeah. And earnings growth as well, EPS at those businesses. So again, I think that this is something that people should change their orientation and actually realize that they're not only not mutually exclusive. In fact, they're very closely related in terms of impact and financial returns.
It's interesting because up until now, at least in public markets, which we talk about most often here, you'll see sort of, you know, funds starting one specific climate fund or an ETF that's pro, you know, diversity. And when I was talking with Kyu-Sun Lee, your boss, yesterday at the Super Return Conference, he was saying, no, we want to take a more holistic approach. And it's not just about one investment vehicle, but about this is the way we run not only our company, but also the companies that we invest in.
I think that many people approach this as a screen, where essentially they want to limit the number or the types of companies that they can invest in. And I think that is perhaps the wrong approach. Because if you're a control investor, if you're a private investor, where you have significant influence over the business, you should be incorporating these ideas and a total improvement orientation into every investment that you make. So rather than circumscribing the universe of companies you invest in, just make these changes everywhere that your capital is deployed.
Why is it, do you think? I mean, I remember an old example of a very famous footwear company that had, you know, a boardroom full of guys who were saying, how can we sell more products to women? And there was only one woman in there. And she said, you know, hire more of me, maybe.
Yeah.
That I get. But what about, you know, climate, supporting the climate in terms of governance? Why do all of these things work out to improve returns?
Well, so what's interesting about climate is that when you look at the energy sector, there's a huge dispersion in valuations on the basis of whether it's renewable and sustainable or whether it's fossil fuel. So, for example, if we take companies that are purely involved in fossil fuels, valuations are about 5 times trailing EBITDA. If you look at businesses that are entirely renewable, sustainable, it's actually valuations that can be as high as 14, 15 times. In fact, in some cases, much higher than that. But there's very few companies that are just pure play. So what we found is that businesses that are in the oil and gas space, if they take those cash flows and reinvest them into renewable and sustainable energy, they actually can increase their valuation by about, if they get up to about a 40% in terms of the revenue mix that comes from renewable and sustainable energy, they can actually double their valuation from a roughly 5 times to 10 or 11 times. So I think that's an example of how an investment in moving towards sustainable energy and improving the climate and you know, achieving sustainability actually generates pretty significant financial returns.
All right, it's a fascinating paper, and I recommend everyone try and take a look at it. Let's talk for a moment about the coronavirus. Obviously, is the main issue that I think people were talking about at Super Return and that we're focused on here in markets as well. My thinking immediately goes to, how do I get safe? You know, which assets are safer for me to invest in if we see the S&P 500 start to fall 10, 20%? One of the things people were saying yesterday is that maybe private capital is better is better suited to a downturn than public markets? And you say there's data that
I think when you look at the vintage years that are generally associated with recessions or downturns, those are precisely the vintage years that we have the largest outperformance. Those are the best times to actually invest in private capital. Much of it is related to governance. And generally what you see is that actions to strengthen the business in anticipation of a downturn occur in private companies 6 months to 9 months earlier than the case for comparable public businesses. So it's really just that those tripwires and the intensity of the monitoring from the private model just, again, leads to much quicker decision-making. And I think it's that you're getting ahead of problems relative to public companies. So that the data are clear in the outperformance, and that's my supposition as to why that outperformance exists, just that they improve governance, faster decision-making.